You are a new parishioner or a visitor from another parish. You welcome. Our celebrant is our pastor, Father Kraynak. As we gather, let us sing number 302, Gathered People, number 302, please sing.
Physical beauty are of value in comparison to wisdom. sense of other good things in life. As we begin our celebration, we reflect on our relationship with God and with our world.
Lord Jesus, you warned against the wealth of this world. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ Jesus, you champion the people who are generous. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you saw money as a means rather than an end. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Yet all good things together come to me in her company, and Word of God is living and effective, sharper than any two-edged sword, penetrating even between soul and spirit, joints and marrow, and able to discern reflections and thoughts of the heart. No creature is concealed from him, but everything is naked and exposed to the eyes of him to whom we must render an account. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Gospel. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
We've all heard that market saying, love makes the world go round. Or is it money makes the world go round and love just makes the trip worthwhile? Love is the most often mentioned thing in the Bible. The only other thing that comes in a close second is money, wealth, and riches. These past few weeks we've been reading from Mark as Jesus and the disciples make their way on their journey to Jerusalem. We've heard them arguing amongst themselves about who would be the greatest in the kingdom, to which Jesus replied that the least would be the greatest, and that they were to be the servant to all. Then we heard strong language from Jesus about cutting off hands and feet and gouging out eyeballs, the lesson being to do what it takes to prevent sin from hindering our relationship with God. Last week we heard about the dissolubility of marriage. This week we tackle wealth and our relationship with money and worldly things. Shortly after we were married, I left my job at the University of Washington and went to work for a software company. It was the late 1990s in Seattle, and they'd take anybody with a pulse. It's the only reason they took me. It was an entry-level job. It wasn't anything fancy. But a couple weeks afterwards, we came home from my wife's office Christmas party, and there was a big envelope waiting for me. It came in the mail that day. And I opened it up, and it was a stock option grant. And the way stock options work is the company gives you the option to purchase a certain number of shares of stock at the price, usually the day you started, so that you can buy it for that price, regardless of what the market price is, and then sell it. So if it was $10 that day and it's $20 this day, you can sell it and realize that $10. Things have been going pretty well since I started, and it was already worth hundreds of thousands of dollars. That was a shock. The catch is, you have to wait a couple of years before you can exercise the options. So usually some of them are available in a year, some in 2 years, and the rest in 3 years. That's fine. Well, what they do is they serve as kind of a golden handcuff to keep you shackled to the company, because you can't walk away from that kind of money. If you go, you lose it. The rest of that story is that it continued to go up, past $1 million, kept on going. What we didn't know was that was the tail end of the dot-com boom. And you know it comes right after the tail. So within a couple of months, it wasn't worth the postage that they used to send it to. The point is that money, wealth, and possessions can keep us from doing other things. They can hold us captive. Today's gospel reading, Matthew and Luke refer to this guy as a young man and as a ruler. And we know from later on that he had many possessions. So he's often referred to in all three of the Gospels as the rich young ruler, the rich young man. This young man has heard this message that Jesus is preaching, and he's very attracted to it. So he asks Jesus, what do I have to do to inherit eternal life? What do I have to do to enter into this kingdom of heaven, this kingdom of God that you're talking about? Jesus gives the answer he was probably expecting, follow the commandments, etc. Of course, he had followed these his whole life, but Jesus tells him that isn't quite enough. Notice that the man's question was, what must I do? As though there were a way to win entrance into the kingdom, a way to earn eternal life. As though there was a series of tasks that he could complete and check off boxes up to a certain point where he would automatically get in. Of course, that's not how it works. Jesus knew what the young man was thinking, and he also knew that he was really serious about it. He knows that what he's going to tell him isn't what he wants to hear. Jesus looks at him, and he's moved with love for him, and he loved him enough to tell him the truth. Sell all that you have and give it to the poor. Jesus, the very word of God, the power of God, could see into that man. He could see between his soul and his spirit, his joints and marrow. He could discern reflections and thoughts of that man's heart. He knew that the thing holding this man back was his wealth, his possessions. The man wasn't expecting this, and he went away sad. We don't necessarily know that he didn't come around and sell everything, but for now, the kingdom of heaven seemed out of reach to him. As I mentioned before, wealth is the second most mentioned thing in the Bible after love, usually not in a terribly positive way. The problem with wealth is that it can very easily lead us into a sense of worldly power. Woe to you rich, we hear often throughout the scriptures. And Psalm 49 speaks of the impossibility of buying heaven. Those who trust in their own strength are driven like sheep into the underworld, where death is their shepherd. Only God can rescue us. Like cutting off an offending hand or plucking out an offending eyeball, material possessions and money can be a distraction from the things of God. Riches can be gained at the expense of other people through slavery and exploitation, but it doesn't have to be that way. Each one of us is different, and each one of us has different temptations. Jesus knew that what was holding the rich young man back was his possessions. That was the foot he needed to cut off. Just this week, the church celebrated the feast day of one of our greatest saints, who was called by God to a life of radical poverty. St. Francis, who was a permanent deacon, by the way, was also a rich young man who had a profound conversion experience. In opening a Bible at random places, he found three times passages that spoke of renouncing earthly wealth and decided that that's what God was calling him to do. It's the famous scene where his father demanded that he renounce his inheritance, and he literally divests himself of everything, even the clothes he's wearing, and after that point, only accepts what's given to him. And as he lay dying 795 years ago this week, he borrowed a blanket, removed everything else, and lay down under it. He died the way he was born, and the way he lived his life after his conversion, with absolutely nothing. God continues to call numerous men and women to lead such lives of radical poverty over the years. But the vast majority of those he called to follow him, then and now, weren't expected to go quite that far. Most of us are called to the married state. Spouses are called to work and to provide for the needs of each other, and we're expected to provide enough to care for, feed, and educate the children, which we hope will come along. We need to be able to cover our medical expenses and save up enough to provide for when we aren't able to work anymore. And that's okay. But wait, it's easier for a camel to pass through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. And believe me, every person in this room is fabulously wealthy compared to billions of others in the world right now. We can't enter that kingdom of heaven on our own. None of us can. For human beings, it is impossible, but not for God. All things are possible for God. We're all called to give up all of those things that distract us from God. And it's incumbent on us to remember that everything we have is from God and belongs to God. It's incumbent on us to be detached from the things of this world. This is wisdom. Wisdom, the gift from God, prayed for by Solomon in the first reading. Wisdom, the gift of the Holy Spirit, we receive at confirmation. We're told to seek her constantly by being in relationship with God. Then we can discern what is truly valuable to us, to determine what's helping us on our journey to the heavenly Jerusalem, and what is holding us back. What is helping us to love God and our neighbor, or hindering us from doing that? The rich young man in today's gospel was not free to follow Jesus with his whole heart. He was owned by his wealth, owned by his possessions. Do we own our possessions? Do we control our wealth? Or does our wealth and our possessions only control us? Does love of God and love of our neighbor make our worlds go round? Or does money make your world go round? Thank you.
With faith in our God, whom nothing is impossible, we pray for the needs of the church and the world.
That the church might embody the word of God and help all believers to know the saving power of Christ, we pray to the Lord. The rich nations may find new ways to help those in poverty and to respond quickly to the victims of natural disaster. We pray to the Lord. The families will place human life ahead of financial assets. We pray to the Lord. That all families may be a haven of love and acceptance. We pray to the Lord. That our possessions may never become an obstacle to faith, and that those who have taken the vow of poverty might enjoy freedom in their choice. We pray to the Lord. For all those who have served in the military, may they be kept safe from harm as they work for peace. We pray to the Lord. For those intentions we pray for daily, and for the intention of this Mass, we pray to the Lord.
Kathy and Andy Renovich, would you please come forward with your daughters and your grandson? They are celebrating this day their 45th wedding anniversary. We pray. Praise to you, O God. We bless you, creator of all things. In the beginning, you made man and woman, that they might form a communion of life and love. We also give thanks for graciously blessing the family and life of your servants, Kathy and Henry, so that it might present an image of Christ's union with his church. Therefore, look with kindness upon them today, as you have been sustaining them in their communion amid the joys and struggles of life. Renew their marriage covenant each day, increase their charity, and strengthen them in their bond of peace, that together, surrounded by their children, they may forever enjoy your blessing. We ask this in Christ our Lord. Congratulations.
Thank you.
good Lord God of all creation, the goodness we have this wine to offer through the vine and word of the mass. Let become for us our spiritual drink. Blessed be God. Lord, we ask that you receive us in the sacrifice we offer with humble and contrite hearts. Lord, wash away my iniquity, cleanse me from my sins. Let us pray, my friends, for our sacrifice. The God, our Almighty Father, may the Lord accept the Lord, we pray, of your faithful with this sacrificial offering, that through these acts of devotion, we may pass over to the glory of heaven, through Christ. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just our duty and our salvation always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For you so loved the world that in your mercy you sent us, the Redeemer, to live like us in all things but sin, so that you might love in us what you love in your Son, by whose obedience we have been restored to those gifts of yours, that by sinning we had lost by our disobedience. And so, Father, with all the angels and saints, we praise you as in joyful celebration we acclaim. In similar way, when supper was entered into the chalice, again he gave thanks and praise, gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink. This is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for all, so that sins may be forgiven. Do this in memory of me. Oh, Mr. Ray of Faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and ministry. Humbly, we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church, spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity. Together with Francis, Pope, David, our bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and with all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever.
receive spiritual communion as you watch this Mass at home, please pray along with us. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament of the altar. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. If you would please have a look at the bulletin again. There are several RSVP forms for different events coming up in November. Have a careful look at them, decide which ones you would like to attend, and please let us know so that we can plan accordingly. Also, the Infant of Prague will be celebrating 60 years here at Immaculate Conception. There will not be a meeting on November 13th. Rather, they will all gather, or all gather at the IC Social Hall for our spaghetti dinner, during our spaghetti dinner, at 4:30 on October 21st. Congratulations to the Infant of Prague deal for 60 years here at Immaculate. See at 4:30 on the 21st at the spaghetti dinner.
Let us pray. We entreat your Majesty most humbly that as you feed us with the nourishment that comes from the most holy body and blood of your Son, so you may make us shares in his divine.